Before I begin, let me first just pose to the audience, is there any specific questions around the area of employment and persons with psychiatric disabilities that you'd like us to ponder, address, at least talk about while we discuss what probably what little we know in the whole area, but is there any particular questions or areas of interest you'd like us to address? I'm not a benefits specialist, but I can talk to it in kind of a more, you know, in an overview. As Rita said, you know, there's probably a lot of anxiety associated, a lot of hope, a lot of expectation, and also a lot of anxiety about either going to work for the first time or returning to work after having issues with a mental illness. One of the biggest roadblocks or hurdles is, will employment affect my benefits? And am I going to lose my Medicaid or my Medicare if I go back to work? In most instances, I would say no, you would not, because Social Security has a number of different programs that are designed to help people go back to work and maintain their benefits. And of course, in Ohio, we're looking at becoming, I'm thinking of the legislation.
Medicaid buy-in,
that's right. And the good folks at the Ohio Advocates have been working very hard. Ohio Advocates for the Mentally Ill have been working very hard on this legislation because it really has more benefits associated with it than what was typically the standard programs, the PASS program and the IRWIs, achieving. Maybe my coworker PASS and IRWI. Do you know what those stand for?
A plan for
achieving self-sufficiency. That's it.
Self-sufficiency and impairment-related work
expenses. Right. And because it's hard to remember what they stand for, you can kind of imagine that they're somewhat complicated to figure out. Not all the folks that when you contact Social Security, not all of them share the same knowledge base when it comes to benefits and returning to work. Then you have also the Ticket to Work program, and GCB is an employer network and can accept people's tickets. There's a lot of confusion about what that ticket means and how that might affect your benefits if you get involved in the ticket. But I believe Social Security is making some efforts, and the Medicaid buy-in, if it is passed, and right now I believe they're working on the rules. It has been passed, they're working on the rules, and I think once that's in place, there will be some opportunities to at least buy into your health insurance, pretty much like everybody else does, pays a premium, and it would be a fairly low premium. Medicaid buy-in should eliminate the need for spend down as well. That's one of the pluses associated with Medicaid buy-in. You know, again, I'm not an expert on benefits. GCB relies on the Legal Aid Society. We have a great partnership with them. They come to our offices, they work directly with our clients who are in our Ticket to Work program, and they make themselves available to work with us to deal with questions specifically related to benefits and going back to work. There are some very, very rare and unique instances where the individual's benefits are such that it's really not in their best interest to go back to work, but those are very rare and few and far between. For the most part, work does produce recovery, and going back to work and getting into the mainstream of life can facilitate recovery from mental illness. It's certainly, there's things that we know about work and mental illness. We know that people who are mentally ill and return to work or go to work have fewer symptoms. We know that they are less likely to use expensive psychiatric interventions or hospitalizations. We know that they report higher satisfaction, higher quality of life scores and better satisfaction with life in the Ohio Outcomes Study, that overall they experience a better quality of life through employment. These are things that I've seen personally. I've been doing this for 20 plus some years. I started in the organization that Crystal works in, saw the effect that work had, the profound effect that getting a job has on somebody who is disabled, whether they're psychiatrically disabled or just disabled from something else, that it produces just a transformation in them. We see people that we have worked with, that we find them jobs, and then then they get an apartment, or they buy their first car. They become self-sufficient. They become what I call, they get back into the procession of life. You know, our culture in the United States is we are identified by what we do in life. You know, what kind of job we have or who we work for. This is our identity. And it's unfortunate that folks with mental illness, their identity is that of being mentally ill. But when you talk to folks who go to work, they say that I'm no longer identified as as mentally ill. I'm a person who happens to have mental illness, but I'm also a person who happens to be an employee, or a person who happens to be a friend, or that the mental illness isn't the all identifier of the individual. The things we know are that there's 70,000 plus adults in the state of Ohio who have mental illness. We know that. And we know that probably 85% of them are not working. So you constantly ask yourself, well, why is that? We have vocational programs. We have the Bureau of Vocational Rehabilitation. We have services out there that can help people get back to work, but why aren't they being used, or why aren't they working? Well, another thing that we've found, and I'm sure all of you understand, is the area of stigma. When we try to place somebody at Greater Cincinnati Behavioral Health, we take the words Greater Cincinnati Behavioral Health off of our stationery. We take it off of our business cards. We use generic stationery. We use generic business cards because we don't want to go in to an employer with a strike against us, thinking that the stigma associated with mental illness is pervasive in all aspects of our society. So we want to give the clients that we're working with a heads up on how we try to place them. We have a number of programs, one of which is a collaboration with the Bureau of Vocational Rehabilitation, where we provide supported employment through referrals that they make to us. And we have what's called community-based assessments, where we try people out in real jobs in the community where they get a real wage. So that's one aspect of our business, is through our gracious funding support from BVR. But we also have a number of other programs that are funded through the Mental Health Board. And those programs include a number of businesses that we operate, where people can work in those businesses, and they could go to BVR or they could go to other programs that we have. We have a business in commercial cleaning and food service catering and grocery warehouse distribution operation, and also in lawn and grounds maintenance and landscaping. So, we employ folks. Some of those folks make, the state compensatory minimum, which right now is $7 an hour, but some of them are making close to $14 an hour on our federal contracts. So some of them are pretty good jobs. They're transitional jobs. They're not permanent jobs, but we hope then to move them to permanent jobs after that. We have a program that is our employment network. We accept tickets to work, and it's called our Touchstone Employment Network. And it serves as a alternative to the Bureau of Vocational Rehabilitation. It's for folks who may have gone through BVR and did not have a positive experience, or that they don't want to go to BVR. They just kind of want to stay within the organization. Typically for folks that work less than 20 hours a week, and they want to work and build up to their employment capacity on a gradual basis. They might start out at 5 hours per week and eventually get to 20. Or it could very well be that the ticket holder does want to work for 40 hours a week and does come through us. And in some instances, we've tried to, coordinate our care with BVR through a memorandum of understanding. We spend a lot of time trying to educate case managers, and all of you are either family members or you might be consumers within the mental health system, and that case managers often don't have a long tenure in their job, and you may experience a number of case managers either working with somebody that is dear to you or working directly with you. And it's very hard, I think, when you see that change of personnel over and over and over again, to try to get consistency in creating an outcome of recovery. it really does add a little bit of a stumbling block. And it adds a stumbling block to us as we try to educate those case managers about employment services. And we do our best, but sometimes we are often challenged by trying to train our new personnel and trying to keep them trained about, you know, how to access vocational services. We certainly strive to get as many folks as engaged as possible. Right now, on any given day, we're working with about 500 folks in vocational services. That's a lot in all of our various programs, some of which are funded by various funding sources. And, you know, and again, our outcomes are pretty significant. Of that 500, we get almost 260 of those individuals placed in employment. That's a pretty good statistic. And we keep those folks, typically 100% of the folks that we place stay placed for 45 days. That drops down to, you know, that might drop down to 60-something percent that stay for 90 days, which is a threshold that's used in employment services. But we strive to get people in employment, to stay in employment, and then to move beyond where they're at through some type of career development or through counseling. And again, we don't really say goodbye to people, especially in our Touchstone program, where we'll follow them for extended periods of time. And again, if you just kind of disregard the names of the program and kind of look at the overall scope of what we're trying to do, it's essentially trying to get people engaged with the idea of, do they want to work? And what are the fears that have kept them from working in the past? Of course, one of the big fears is, am I going to lose my benefits? Am I going to lose my Medicaid or Medicare? And if I do, how am I going to, you know, keep going without the medications that I'm on? That's the biggest fear. But another issue is just the mental health system itself, where only 1% of the board's resources go towards vocational rehabilitation. When you look at the board's, the Mental Health and Recovery Services Board of Hamilton County, it's really less than 1% of their total assets or revenue go for vocational services. It can't be funded through Medicaid. That's a big issue. Vocational services cannot be funded through Medicaid. So you have to use those board hard dollars, as they call them, to fund our services. And there's a limited amount of those to go around for various initiatives. So you have to be creative when you're in vocational services to figure out, well, how can I generate revenue from other sources, or what other resources can I use? Well, we use the resource of BVR. And let me just ask, how many of you are familiar with the Super Jobs Center? One person, three people, four, five, six. Well, as you know, some of you know because you're in GCB. We have this wonderful facility called the Super Jobs Center that our case managers don't really know very much about. Certainly our clients don't know very much about it. They have training programs there. They have a wealth of job information there. They have computer training programs. They have resources that people can access. There's one of these, they're called one-stop career centers, and there's one, they either are in a specific county or they represent a group of counties, and they're throughout the United States. Now, they're managed differently in different states, but in Ohio, they could be run by for-profit organizations or not-for-profit organizations. From my opinion, the very best one-stop in the state of Ohio is run in Toledo. It's called The Source. It's run by a mental health agency, and it does an absolutely phenomenal job of welcoming people with disabilities and with mental health disabilities into the one-stop and working with them to help them get good employment outcomes. It is by far the best in the state of Ohio, and I wish we had The Source in every county in Ohio, but we don't. So we have to develop good relationships and, you know, get to learn about our one-stop center, which is the Super Job Center, and to visit it and to encourage your membership to learn about it, to encourage folks, case managers, to say, hey, I'd like to learn about the one-stop, take me down there, and kind of help them navigate through it. There's also a satellite office at Jordan's Crossing in Bond Hill, which is the one that we use through our Touchstone program. But, you know, once you establish the relationship, you can kind of maneuver through that system. It's another system. BBR is a system, the mental health system is a system, and then you've got this whole workforce system, which is the one-stops. And you just kind of have to realize that there's resources for the person in each one of these. And you have to figure out how to kind of navigate through these systems to get a hold of these resources to get the end result, which is the best possible arrangement of services to help you get back to work. You know, and yes, ma'am.
So how do you get to the one stop? Where is it? How do you get to it?
One's at Jordan's Crossings in Bond Hill, which I believe is where the old Swifton Shopping Center is located. And it's right next to there's a library there, and there's Jordan's Crossing and Community Action Agency. The other one is located down on Central Parkway. It's the old unemployment office right on Central Parkway.
I believe it's 1916
Central Parkway. 1916 Central Parkway, yes. That has a much bigger, have greater resources than the one in Jordan's Crossing, but we're very close to the one in Jordan's Crossing, so we use that one pretty.
Can you just go there?
You can walk right in. It's meant for any citizen of Hamilton County can utilize the services of the One Stop, and they'll help register you. You tell them you're interested in learning about what they have to offer for you if you're thinking about going back to work. You don't really have to rely on anybody's system. You can do it on your own if you take a good stance and are assertive in working through those systems. Sometimes you have to be, because they may not be as user-friendly as they could be, certainly not as user-friendly as the source in Toledo. But if you can learn to maneuver through it, there's all kinds of resources that they have, and they'll have them posted in the lobby of the one-stops to learn about them. Yes, sir.
My kid has Asperger's syndrome, and he is working right now. He was placed through GCD and one of its employment programs over at Sherwin-Williams Paint Store, where he's been like forever. And he's been there forever, working half-time at just a bit over minimum wage, for the longest time. And it seems to us, when we go back to the agency saying, this is not like a place where you make a living and establish your life to where you can live on your own, move out, grow up, do all those things. How do you persuade an agency to take you to the next step or to help you get to the next step? Especially if you've got the kind of disability that does not make you an outgoing social person.
Well, the individual, if this is your son, should really be talking to their job coach. Are they seeing a job coach? Is a job coach there with them?
My son has been placed. Everyone is satisfied now that he has a job.
But there should be a coach involved with that job. There should be somebody seeing him on a regular basis.
He doesn't need coaching. He's got, a job that, he can do without modifications or adjustments. He just needs help getting the better job where he can make a living.
I don't know what program your son is in with GCB.
He had been in a placement program.
Was that funded through BVR?
Oh, sure.
Okay.
And, it was fine that he got placed. But he's been placed for, years. At what point do people help folks get further along? Because he's like 25 years old. And, at some point, he needs to have, a real job in this world.
Well, I would suggest, it sounds like he came through BVR, so that's, and they placed him, and because, would he not be receiving maintenance coaching? He would not be getting maintenance coaching.
He didn't qualify for the maintenance follow-along coaching, where someone would have still continued to follow along with
right.
him. So he would have to return to BVR and let them know he's interested in pursuing another job, and they would have to reopen his case.
Well, we've done that. I mean, what do you need to do when the person that you work with at BVR says, well, we've not been successful?
Well, why would they, I'll let Crystal address this, but if he's been working successfully, then he is a success. And, you know, if he wants to move into, if it's his desire to move into another position or get additional training, then that's something that would be discussed with a BVR counselor.
But BVR is satisfied that working for 15 to 20 hours a week at $7 or $8 an hour is sufficient for a person. That's the barrier that we reach, is that BVR tells us, you know, that he has reached, you know, his capacity when we know in fact that he hasn't. You know, it's difficult. I know that it's difficult to place people, you know, in this world. You know, and it's much more easy to place a person when you have a captive source of employment opportunities, like your transitional employment program or the old-fashioned sheltered workshop. When you move beyond that and you're trying to place people at their full capacity in employment, you know, to where they can actually make a make a significant living. For example, he's been working in the warehouse in the back. He could just as well be working for 40 hours in a warehouse anywhere in the city. How do you persuade BVR to take him to that 40-hour place?
Well, I work for BVR, and so I'll take a stab at this. I'll take a stab at this. The Bureau of Vocational Rehabilitation, for anybody who isn't familiar with who we are and what we do, we are the state agency that helps individuals who have a disability get and keep jobs. And our goal is to get people into employment that's going to match their skills, interests, and abilities in an entry-level position in the community. And it sounds like the situation you're describing, he has a community job that he's not having any problem doing. Every case is looked at on an individualized basis, and eligibility is always determined at the time of application. It's based on three things. One, presence of a physical or mental impairment that is documented by a licensed professional, that impairment is an impediment to employment, so it's affecting the ability to do a job and that they benefit from services. If an individual is working and they're successfully working and it's stable employment, then it may be a question of eligibility as to whether the person is eligible for our services at this time.
So what you're saying is that if the person's working 20 hours a week, but could easily like get a better job, and if they were not disabled, they could get a better job and actually make a living at that job, that person could still be considered not eligible for your services. Is that what you're saying?
That eligibility is based on presence of a physical or mental impairment, that's an impediment to employment, and that they benefit from services. Now, a piece of that may be looking at whether that employment is stable and that the individual is able to have access to benefits. And every individual circumstance, we have to build a case for eligibility as part of our fiscal responsibility, being a state agency, and also 80% of our funding is from the federal government.
Is your son being served through the mental health system of Hamilton County?
No, he is through the MRDD system.
Well, MRDD, and we serve that population. You're gonna turn me off?
Oh, it is on.
It is on. Can everybody hear me? MRDD does work with us, and we do provide follow-along coaching through their program. Is he in the adult system with MRDD?
Yes, he's got a case manager.
Or a facilitator.
Okay. Occasionally, because he's not in crisis. You know,
okay.
But, you know, people who are not in crisis, you know, the important thing for them is to try and establish an independent life, which my son is fully capable of.
I would suggest that you work with your son's service facilitator at MRDD, ask them to be re-referred to our LINCS program, which works exclusively with folks from that system, and also provides follow-along coaching and can provide additional career development with him to move to the next step. So there are options for your son, but you'll have to work with your service facilitator and MRDD to make that referral happen.
Thanks.
And it's called the Links Program. And we could work in tandem with VR through that program or not. It depends on what the service facilitator would like to do. But the board of MRDD also provides funding to Greater Cincinnati Behavioral Health to provide vocational services and follow-along services and exactly what you're talking about, career development services. So there are possibilities for him through that program.
Thank you.
Okay.
And Debbie referred to the one-stop earlier. It is freely available to anyone in the community. They have job fairs there. They have career coaches, so they do have individuals who are collaborating with GCB, with MRDD, with BVR, with many, many partners within Cincinnati and Hamilton County to help people into employment.
And also the One Stop now just recently got a grant for a disability services navigator. And we're hopeful, I worked with their the Workforce Investment Board president to put that grant together. And we're hopeful that this disability navigator who will be assigned to the One Stop, then for people who do have disabilities that walk in the door, that navigator will be there to help them navigate that system. Because again, you got the MR, you know, you're working with your son. You got the MRDD system, which is different than the mental health system and the BVR system and the one-stop system. And it becomes a little overwhelming, I think, to people with disabilities that want to get a job and want to work. Well, what's the easiest way? And it's really, you know, and I feel personally bad that just getting a person into an organization requires them to fill out so many pieces of paper. And being asked the same questions over and over again. But, you know, that's kind of how the system works. And, you know, if you go through the map, you know, they ask you questions and you come into an agency and they ask you questions and you get into a program and they may be asking you the same questions. It's not exactly customer friendly. You wouldn't see this in corporate America. You know, they would streamline this somehow, but I'm not sure I personally can fix that other than try to make it as easy as possible for folks to engage quickly with the people that they're going to work with and try to get a job as quickly as possible. Because I firmly believe that work produces recovery from mental illness. I've seen it happen over and over again with individuals that we've placed in employment. Diane, you had a question?
Oh, I was just going to follow up on what Paul was saying. I think that really speaks to the issue. I know I hear a lot, not just about employment, but about housing and about medications that, I think there is a tendency in any kind of system that once the fire is put out, there are still lots of other fires. And if a person is not, I'm sad to say it, if a person is not a squeaky wheel, they don't get as much attention. And
no.
That's where friends and loved ones can help advocate at whatever the next planning meeting or call, ask, you know, get your loved one to ask for a planning or ask for one yourself with your case manager. And this is just in the mental health system, to say, you know, I might seem like I don't have any problems, but I also don't want to stay right here.
Right.
That's a hard thing to sustain.
I know when we work with MRDD, you know, sometimes my staff get frustrated because the parents take such an aggressive stance and on behalf of the advocacy on behalf of their daughter or son, and then it's just, you know, they become a central figure in the case. But then you have to step back and look and say, gosh, if I had that problem, I would want someone advocating to that extent for me. So it's an interesting phenomena that, you know, we welcome, you know, folks that advocate, but, you know, in the mental health system, you very rarely find advocates that are parents or loved ones or family that you see in the MRDD system. It's a very, very different reality. Yes?
Question about this one-stop employment service. So someone could go and get help with, say, interview skills or something mm-hmm. that basic?
They have all kinds of introductory classes on how to write a resume, how to do an interview. They have coaches there, career coaches or counselors that work with folks.
So yeah. You would just go in and tell them what you want and apply, and then they would hook you up with those services.
For free, yes.
And there's no requirement of disability or anything like that.
No, anyone in Hamilton County, if you've been displaced from employment, you know, the Super Job Center really, you know, the whole concept, they merged job and family, it's called Job and Family Services now. We used to have the Unemployment Bureau and the Welfare Department. Well, those two merged under the Taft administration, and now we've got Department of Job and Family Services, which really play a significant role in the one-stop. So their goal is, they work with a lot of people who are on TANF, the welfare-to-work population. Displaced workers often come there. Companies call them if they need assistance, so they have placement specialists there, but also people that need a little help or may need a short-term training program. What they have, the Workforce Investment Act, WIA, provided for funds for training, you know, and it's really kind of a, it could be an alternative to VR or it could be a complement to VR, you know, when all those systems work together. And, you know, I'm working with a statewide group that is really working towards that effort, that, you know, that all these systems recognize one another and work together for the benefit of the people that need it, especially folks with disabilities that have to kind of navigate through these places to get to the end result, which is help me get a job, a good job that I can keep. But yes, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to add, there is a requirement to register for their services when you arrive, but then they have a computer lab, they have typically resume paper, you can fax things directly from there. Many companies have applications on site, so you could fill out an application right there. So many employers do on-site interviews. They come to that location. They have job fairs periodically that they post information about. There is a website that I can't tell you off the top of my head, but if you put in a Google search for Super Job Center,
Cincinnati, near Hamilton County, you'll find it.
I'm curious what you'd have to say about if you were to go to one of these one-stop centers for assistance. Now, as I understand, this is open to anyone who needs assistance, whether they have a mental disability or not. And given what you had to say about the stigma of mental illness, are you better served to not say anything about that if you go to one of these one-stops, or do you make that a point as one of your disabilities?
You know, you could easily say, I'm a person who has a disability and I'm going to need some assistance learning how to navigate through the one stop. You really don't have to disclose your disability. All you have to do is say, you know, I'm a person with a disability and I'm going to need your help to get through this. When they have the disability navigator, it's going to be much better, and hopefully that person should be in place within at least a couple months.
That's going to be with your agency?
No, it's, you know, I helped with the grant for that. Because it's a one-year thing, I think it's going to be a contracted position. I'm not sure who's going to take it. I've been contacting people who have retired from her place to see if they might be interested in doing that work.
Where did you say this one-stop is located?
There's two of them. The one, at least the one that we work with, is the Jordan's Crossing, which is the old Swifton's Shopping Center in Bond Hill, which is a very nice satellite. It's right next to the Community Action Agency and the library there. It's a very nice facility. And then the bigger one is located on Central Parkway, where the old unemployment office used to be, just right before you get downtown.
Before Finley Market.
Yes, I think it's right before Finley Street. As a matter of fact, it'll be going south. It'll be on your left-hand side.
Oh, really?
It's there.
It's right there.
And anybody can walk in. I mean, I would encourage anyone in this room to go down and take a look at it on your own, see what it's like, and kind of figure it out. And if you have a loved one, take them with you to help maneuver through it. Yes.
And in the phone book, it's like one stop.
It's called the Super Job Center.
Super Job Center.
What?
Super Jobs Center. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
So are these all entry-level jobs?
No, the Super Job Center has positions that range from entry-level to, you know, just what you would find on careerbuilder.com. I mean, you'll have a whole gamut of positions that they're trying to fill.
And they're developing relationships with employers in addition to those employers who may be present or have an on-site presence periodically. They also have a bank of jobs that they're available of, or that they've worked with employers to identify, and they have access to those on a website there.
And there's a VR counselor that spends time at the Super Job Center on a regular basis. So you can really kind of connect with a BVR counselor on site there as well.
Because like for myself, I have a master's degree. So if I go to get an entry level job, and then, you know, if I would go full time to work and go off my disability, it's not going to cover what I make on disability. So what's the incentive when I'm trying to put my daughters through school?
Well, the incentive, you know, again, you have the educational background and the will and the desire. There are programs through Social Security that will allow you to keep your benefit. Now, your cash benefit will be reduced. That's a certainty.
More importantly to me is the medical. Because
right.
If I can't keep my doctors and my medicine.
Right, but you can keep your medications. You can keep your Medicare, and you can keep your Medicaid if you're in a ticket to work program. As soon as we become a Medicaid buy-in state, you'll be able to earn, I think, in the upper 20s before your Medicaid, or no, that's
Medicaid.
Or the Medicare. The Medicare, if you're in ticket to work, will stay for 9 years while you're in the ticket program, and then it'll eventually fade off, with the expectation that your earnings will increase over that period of time.
Different people you talk to at Social Security, you talk to one, and they'll say that you have to pay more cost up front. Your first week at first month at work, you're paying $1,400 more out of pocket.
Each situation is unique, and that is why we use, because it is complex, and I'm not a benefits specialist, that is why we use the Legal Aid Society to work with each person individually to talk about.
How do you get this legal aid person to work with you?
They come to our Touchstone program at our North office on Reading Road. It's the same building that Crystal is located at, which is the address?
7162 Reading Road.
7162 Reading Road, and that's our Touchstone program. We've got brochures. Crystal and I both brought literature, but the Touchstone program does have information, or the Touchstone program is directly connected with the legal aid representative. And also, the Bureau of Vocational Rehabilitation often purchases a benefits analysis through us, through Legal Aid Society, to look at the risks and benefits associated with going back to work. And they'll tell you very specifically, this is what you're going to have to do in order to kind of eventually fade out of these benefits. And it could be that your situation is, and maybe you shouldn't go back to work. I can't say that.
So far, that's what my doctor tells me. My case manager in the past told me. Now my case manager, I saw her twice this year to fill out her forms. Now she tells me she's gone and I'm getting another one who's temporary, who I don't even know, I haven't met. And so, you know,
but your case manager, right?
Joke.
But your case manager and your doctor are not the persons in charge of your recovery. You are.
Exactly.
You're the person directing
your
recovery.
And that's why I'm trying.
And sometimes your doctor and your case manager are not going to give you those positive messages that yes, you can do this. Yes, you can recover. Yes, you can go back to work. There's a way to figure this out. You know, and again, I would encourage.
Giving those messages. Why are they still employed by your agency?
I can't answer that. I think there are good case managers and bad case managers. I think there are good VR counselors and not so good VR counselors. I think there are good employment workers and not so good. I think the world is made up of a variety of competencies, and you know, you have to hope for the best when you get into a social service systems. It's a myriad of processes and people and paperwork, and you just have to kind of do your best to maneuver through the system and advocate for yourself of what you want with a clear goal in mind of this is what I want to achieve.
Well, and I could say sometimes from the vocational rehabilitation side, we will get recommendations from, or we'll get reports from a doctor saying this individual's not able to work. And sometimes in reading it, it appears as if it's written to help somebody get onto benefits, which sometimes is a very appropriate and needed thing. But our goal is to help people get and keep employment, which may impact the benefits, but ultimately is to help people get work. And sometimes in going back and talking to the doctor, and saying that you want to be working, they'll write a release, or they'll say, yes, you're able to be able to work, which is critical for us to be able to work with somebody towards an employment outcome. And because benefits can be impacted, that benefits analysis that we purchase is a critical piece of it, because we, within our agency, just don't have the time or expertise to keep up with all of the changes that occur within the Social Security Administration. But fortunately, we do have legal aid in Cincinnati, and we have people who do specialize in that, and we have access to their services.
And you will get different messages from different Social Security representatives. They're not going to all tell you the same thing, because they don't all have the same level of knowledge. The contact person at legal aid that we use, her name is Peggy Pleasant. Peggy Pleasant. I don't know her phone number, but she is our liaison with legal aid. She comes to our offices. She works with folks.
She is pleasant.
And in fact, we hire peers. You know, we make a concerted effort to hire peers to do our employment work. We hired a peer employment navigator, which we found through VR. She's highly credentialed, highly talented, and she's grappling with these same issues around benefits. And she'll be the first to tell you that, you know, should I reduce my hours? Should I go out on a limb and make more money? And so she's been working with Peggy around those issues, and we'll probably be addressing that. But that's not a unique situation, and you really need to get some professional consultation to see, well, what will be the impact. So give Peggy a call.
And I would just say, add that if anyone has trouble with the system or wants some advocacy, then that's what NAMI is here for. So if any of you would like that assistance or someone to speak on your behalf, that's what we're about. So.
In 1999, I believe it was 1999, the Social Security Administration, up to that point, had been using VR across the country exclusively to help people get back to work that were on SSI or SSDI. They said, well, we're only getting a small percentage, like less than 3% of these folks that are, once they get on SSI or SSDI, less than 3% ever go back to work. Let's look at alternatives to this. And so we're still going to keep our relationship with the state VRs across the country, but we're going to open it up and say, hey, we're going to create these what's called employer networks, which will function like a VR office, you know, with whatever capacities they have to do that. And they can develop plans, like a VR counselor develops a plan, to help people get back to work. Now, you know, not a lot of organizations jumped on the bandwagon, one, because they may not have had the resources to set a program up like that, or two, they probably have to partner with VR because they may not have had the resources to provide training or education, but they could do supported employment, which is what we do. So our employment network does supported employment. We kind of focus on those folks that don't want to go to VR or been at VR and didn't do well, or VR really didn't want them to come back because they want to work less than 20 hours. So you have these employment networks set up that function like, you know, the VR office, and the goal is to help people get back to work. So what were the benefits of somebody who gets this ticket in the mail and says ticket to work? Well, one benefit is you don't have to go through a continuing disability review. And from my understanding, that's a pretty stressful event for folks. And so if you're in a ticket program, you don't have to do that. If you're in a ticket program, you can stay on your Medicaid up till, I think, a wage threshold of when you're making $25,000, maybe $26,000, if you're on Medicaid. If you're on Medicare, you get to keep your Medicare for about 9 years. They give you extra years on Medicare, so that trial work period really doesn't have an effect when you're involved in a ticket program. So you can relinquish your ticket to VR, or you can relinquish your ticket to an employment network. And there are a few in the community, some that are not actively engaged in it, but, you know, GCB is. I believe it's either the Epilepsy Foundation, I think, is a ticket to work employer network. All of the behavioral health organizations across the state that provide vocational rehabilitation in Dayton, in Akron, in Toledo, they're all employment networks. So being in a ticket program, either through VR or through an employment network, gives you some options. And the VR counselors have been trained in ticket to work. And sometimes the employment network works in conjunction with VR because we don't have the resources at GCB to send somebody to an 8-week training program, but VR does. So we might have a combined rehabilitation plan that includes VR and includes Greater Cincinnati Behavioral Health, and I believe we have had those in the past. So ticket to work has some really nice benefits for the person who wants to go to work. You don't have to go through the continuing medical disability review. You get to keep your Medicaid until you're in the upper $20,000 range of income. Now there's a lot of new rules coming out about ticket to work that hopefully will get more folks interested in becoming employment networks sometime this spring. So we're not quite sure how that's all going to play out, and there's going to be opportunities for more collaboration with VR, especially mental health providers with VR, about how we work these tickets. But Ticket to Work is a really, you know, a really unique program, a new program of Social Security. It didn't replace the plan for achieving self-sufficiency or the impairment-related work expenses. Those are still kind of out there. And it gets kind of boggled down when you think about all how they all work together. But it is an option for folks that if you've got a ticket and you haven't relinquished it, we have a program called Touchstone, or you can take your ticket to VR, either one. There are, if you go, there's a website that describes this. It's called yourtickettowork.com. And it will tell you, you can click on the website and it will tell you all the employment networks in the area where you can give your ticket to, or who you can give your ticket to. It's for people who have a disability. It's the whole idea is to eventually get off of your cash benefits.
If you have a disability, that's right. Not the problem. Right. But if I want to get a job out in the workforce, I can't.
You can't take your ticket to an employer. No.
Yeah, the employers.
And then I would lose my benefits if I went
outside. There are places where an employment network like ours ends up placing people in jobs where they're earning more than the people who place them.
Yes.
So it doesn't restrict what kind of work you get.
Right.
It's just where you go to get the help getting the job.
And
so
you could
use it other places.
You don't take it to the employer, you're taking it to the place that's going to do the placement service for you, that's going to help you assess what your skills are, that's going to help you do your resume, that's going to help you interview. The ticket doesn't go to your employer, it goes to the service that's going to help you.
So you then can get a job anywhere.
Right.
That's my question.
Yeah, it's any kind of job, and I don't want to give a couple examples, but I know we've had great stories about people who
wonderful stories
have advanced degrees,
of, you know,
who went through some time where they needed to get restabilized, get themselves together, learn to manage symptoms, and then they get placed in great jobs.
I think what the key thing is it's not that you're applying to an employer to get a job. The employer network is going to function similar to how vocational rehabilitation does, in that we write a plan for employment and then identify the services that are needed to get that job and keep that job. This is for people with disabilities, and recognizing that you're going to be successful with getting a support team and kind of identifying what is necessary to keep that job and planning ahead. So that's what the employment network would help, is kind of put together a plan for employment and then provide some support services towards reaching that goal.
Yes, Pat.
Oh, yes. I wanted to ask, oh gosh, excuse me, I don't have the word, oh goodness. I know what it is. Christ Hospital and Children's both employ people with disabilities.
The program Project Search that we're referring to started as a collaboration with the school system and MRDD, and it's kind of a work experience and training program where individuals who go into Project Search are typically they haven't accepted their diploma and they're still in the school system. They do a classroom component in a classroom with an instructor there on site, and then they rotate through some different job tryouts at the hospital. It's a great opportunity to get us a feel for several different types of jobs, because a hospital setting has such a variety. And at the end of that year with Project Search, we're able to have a much better sense of the person's strengths that they would take into a job interview, and help them be matched into a job that's appropriate or a good match with their skills, interests, and abilities. I think you're referring to not Project Search, okay, but they do have somebody in their HR department who has a background in working with people with disabilities and is kind of an advocate in talking to the different managers and supervisors who are making those hiring decisions within the organization, and having the familiarity with the various systems and types of support, such as job coaching services. They're able to help navigate those systems and talk to the various departments to help increase the employment opportunities within those systems.
And a question for you, I guess, would be a lot of your services at GCB, and I'm sure at the other agencies as well, is dependent on having a case manager. Could you talk a little bit about what is the requirement to avail yourself of a case manager?
This is a stickling point for me, because we through our Touchstone program are now accepting people who do not have a case manager, who are being treated by a psychiatrist or a psychologist, and we can get a report with a diagnosis on it. I'm currently working with MAP, the Mental Health Access Point. We just had a good discussion with them, saying, hey, there's people that do not need case managers, but they're still not at the point where they can get a job, and they need these employment services. How can we kind of give them the seal of approval? They've gone through MAP, and get them to us. And so we're gonna be continuing those conversations, because they see a benefit to having them come through that pathway, and we do too. So we'll be talking to the board and to MAP to try to make that process a little bit easier. But we have made the decision to allow people to come in without case managers, as long as there's somebody that can say, yes, they have a psychiatric disability.
But does the Touchstone require a Social Security benefit?
Only if you want to go into the Ticket to Work program. You have to be on SSI or SSDI.
So Touchstone is bigger than just the Ticket to Work?
Yes, okay. Ticket to Work is a component of Touchstone.
So the same individual I described to you could conceivably qualify for,
yes,
Touchstone?
Yes,
so.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
As a person comes to that behavioral type and gets a case, about how long has it been?
The average time from when they engage in vocational services to placement is usually about 12 weeks. It usually takes about 12, maybe 13 weeks to, you know, some people are longer, some people are less, but the average time is about 12 to 13 weeks.
And then how about
it's going to vary. Are you referring to when somebody's entering the placement phase of it?
No, if somebody comes into our Touchstone program, okay, for example, and they say they want to get a job. So from the point of entry to the point of the job is around 12 to 13 weeks from the time you get into the program to the job.
Then how about BBR?
It's
the time they come in, and then of course they have to get the documentation. When they get all that, they know the person is or whatever, they have that documentation from that point.
It's gonna vary, and it could be 12 to 16 weeks, and it's gonna depend on the time that they're applying as well. We are a state agency, and we're in the crunch of the many state agencies right now, and under a hiring control, so we have some vacancies in our staff.
So yeah, the governor's
so
cut the budgets, and
it's gonna,
so there's,
yeah,
hiring
so
freezes.
The person, you know, the client or whoever who is waiting, do they have any contact with you? Do you have any contact with them during that interim?
They would be assigned a vocational counselor, who's kind of the point of contact through the process, And we always say that you, as Debbie referred to earlier, you are in control of the process, and you have a point of contact, and we do, through the process, ask that you maintain contact with that counselor. So, and there are some things that can be done up front, regardless of whether we have entered that planning phase or not. We have a nice partnership that GCB is part of called a Career Readiness Workshop that's held at the One Stop, and it's a collaboration of several different agencies that provide services towards employment in the Cincinnati area. And it's a two-week program, you go six times, and really it's informational. One of the partners is Great Oaks that does some intensive interest and aptitudes testing that really helps you, when you're finished with that program, have better handle on some information that will help you in interviewing and identifying a job goal.
The reason I'm asking is because I have a friend that her son has called several times to be in the after that speech with the case manager, and he said the case manager had returned, and then at one point the receptionist or something like that told him that he was in the process of being the case manager, but I don't know this about the Great Oaks program, if they ever suggested to this person to go to the Great Oaks program.
Again, BVR has a lot of vacancies that they're not able to fill because of a hiring freeze from the governor's initiative. The state positions are not being filled due to the budget crisis. There could be that, you know, the person that they were assigned to isn't there any longer, and it may take a little bit longer time, depending on what office, to see a VR counselor. But, you know, if they're in the loop, then what they just, you know, the person needs to just, you know, continue to call back.
He received a letter in April 2007, and still there's not one. And then ends up, that's why I went to the other agency.
Well, again, yeah, you have to take some responsibility too to call, you know.
See, that's the problem with those who have the mental illness, like you were saying, they resent a parent trying to intervene, especially when you're a dog.
I'm sorry to cut the conversation short. It is 8:45. I'm really glad we've had this discussion, and I want to